Welcome to First Baptist Church. Things are a little different here today. If you don't know where you are, this really is a church. But once a year, during the Middletown Festival, we put on this little show. And we started doing it on Sunday morning many years ago for our folks who have a hard time wading through the festival. And so if you're our guest today, for the very first time, you may wonder where you are. Well, you are in a Baptist church, and we're delighted to have you. My name is Jim Cobban, and I'm the pastor here, and I'm trying out a new look today. Let me know how it's working. I may de-age like this every week. I'm supposed to give you just a couple of announcements. If you are game to stay after church and help break the set down, there is a huge reward in store for you. By about 3 o'clock, this will look like a church again. But we bribe you with great pizza, and the soda shop is open for unlimited sundaes and slushes. And that's the bribe. But you got to work first, and then we'll feed you. So if you can stay, we hope you will. Just a word of prayer. We're going to open our service in prayer in just a minute. We remember our member Carol Biggs, who is still in Baptist Hospital. Carol was in the cast, came to every rehearsal, had the costume, had everything ready, and she's in the hospital. So say a prayer for Carol that she'll be released very quickly. And I just want to say that we cannot come to this day without remembering what happened 15 years ago this morning. It was an event that defined our world that we live in. And there's not a day that goes by that we don't live in the aftermath of September 11, 2001. And so, as we open our hearts to the Lord in prayer, I'm going to invite you just for a few moments of silence. And let that silence be filled with gratitude for first responders and our military servicemen and women who are in harm's way around the world. We have some church folks who are where they are because of 9/11 today. And I just want us to open with prayer and a few moments of silence, and then I'll close this. Pray God. Lord, I'm grateful to you that you in your wisdom and mercy have given us this day. And we're grateful for all it holds. For a church family, for a community, for our nation, for our world. We are truly grateful to you, and we lift up our prayers for each of those. We pray for wisdom for our leaders. We pray that they will be guided by your Holy Spirit in insight, discernment. We pray for those who are serving in the United States Armed Forces, the diplomatic corps, those who are seeking peace around the world. We thank you, O God, for the men and women who serve as first responders in our own community. Every day they run into danger, and we ask you to protect them. Lord, today we lift up Carol to you, and we ask you to heal her, restore her to the church family. And Father, we ask you to anoint this service this day, that through the words of this drama and the music, that we would hear your message for us. For this is my prayer in Christ's name.
Amen. I invite you to sing a hymn of praise with us this morning. Praise Him, Jesus, our blessed Redeemer. Would you stand with me? The words will be on the screen, and if you can't see those, it's hymn number 227 in your...
Thank you.
God has so generously blessed us with, and to return to Him. If you're a guest today, don't feel obligated, but you're certainly welcome to participate in our offering. He's leading us up in prayer today.
Please pray with me this morning. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time that we spend here today. Father, this is an example that we will witness this morning of a sacrifice, an offering of time, effort, and love. Lord, we're here to ask your blessing upon these gifts and the monetary gifts that we will receive today. Lord, I pray that these gifts will further the life of this church and your kingdom. For it's in your name that we pray. Amen.
Souvenir of the show. This is our
Broadway on Main 2016 but with any donation, and I mean any donation, you can take this home and this will be a great souvenir for you. Speaking of the show, the setting of this year's show is Chicago in the 1930s, in the middle of the Depression. And our main character is struggling to make ends meet. And as we see his struggle, we see that he begins to discover what the big picture in life is all about. So, without further ado, I'm proud to introduce to you Broadway on Main 2016, The Big Picture.
Dancing got me back on my feet. Plus, the dance studio always served a vegetable tray after practice. It was a typical November evening in 1931 Chicago. The night was cold, the wind biting, and bad news was about to fall in my lap like a sudden snowstorm. What are you doing here?
I'm sure I'm the last person you could have imagined walking through your open door tonight. Stan?
Annabelle?
You used to call me Annie.
I used to be in love. I used to eat pastrami sandwiches with provolone cheese. There are a lot of things I used to do back when I trusted you, when I believed in you, when I cared more about you than life itself, and you just left. I prayed that God would give me answers. Months and months I prayed that He would give me answers. But He never did.
I'm so sorry I hurt you.
I don't care, Annabelle. I don't want to know why you're here. I just want you to go.
But,
for good this time.
But Stan, I can't.
Look, this door is wide open. You had no problem walking out of my life 4 years ago. This time, don't come back.
But Stan, I can't leave now. I'm in trouble. I think my life may be in danger.
Are you sure you're okay? Put my hand on your crying. What's wrong?
Well, the short version is, I owe some people a lot of money. But luckily, I found a painting that's apparently very valuable, and I was told that if I turned over the painting, my debt would be forgiven. But the painting was stolen, and now these men are coming to pick up the painting, and I don't know what to do. And Dan went to look for the painting, and now Dan's missing it.
Wait a minute. Who's Dan?
Oh, he's my husband.
That was a kick in the head. To hear that my former fiancé was married? But why should I care? I certainly had no reason to help her find her painting. Or her husband. But we were in the Depression and I didn't need money. She somehow had enough to pay me. I didn't question her. I just took her money and tried to get some answers. The next day, shortly after 3 o'clock, I dropped in on the Uptown Club. The swanky joint was owned by my friend Angel McCloud. It has long been known as a first-class upscale restaurant and club. For many years, it had catered to the wealthy and somewhat famous. But in the early 30s, there weren't too many of them left. More and more of the low-class, shady types seemed to seep in under the doors and through the cracks. This is what I was counting on. I'd hoped Angel might have heard something about the painting or Annie's husband. I'm here for business, not pleasure, right? Angel, I really need to talk to you.
Hey! Who forgot to take out the trash? Sorry about that. Anyway, before we get too serious, I'd like you to meet my newest employee. Girl, get out here! Nora Nightingale, Crystal Clementine, Wanda Waterfall, I'd like you to meet my good friend, Stan Slade.
Pleasure's all mine, handsome. Aren't you a tall drink of water?
Pleasure's mutual, I'm sure.
It's nice to meet you, ladies, and all, but Angel, I was really hoping you could help me with something.
No secrets here, Stan. What do you need?
All right. This painting was stolen. Have you seen it?
Well, I can't say that I have, but I'm not much of an art collector. Sorry, dear.
Never seen it before.
I've never seen it before either, but I kind of like it.
I've never seen it before either. But why would somebody paint a picture upside down? I still haven't seen it before.
Okay, all right, I got it, all right. One more thing. Check out this. The sketch. Have you seen him?
Nope. Sorry.
Nope.
How about you?
Sorry.
No. Gosh.
Not now, darling. Don't you cry.
Yeah. Big boys don't cry.
You're wrong, Wanda. You see, boys cry all the time. Little boys and big.
You got that right. My man hadn't quit crying since the crash.
Men can't handle it. Most men can't. But you can't, Stan Slade. You see, you're more like us.
we don't cry.
Secretary know. I knew Carolina Caldwell would have things under control. She always did.
Something like this would be perfect for this Saturday. Can I help you?
Is Stan Slade here?
Yeah, Stan here.
Who's asking?
What do you mean, who's asking? What do we look like?
Yeah, who do you think we are?
Do you need some glasses?
I think you need some new glasses.
We're asking, that's who.
What's your names, idiots?
No need to get cranky, dollface. Just, why didn't you just say so? My name is Buddy Buffoon. And that's Corky.
Corky Clipper Offer, how do you do?
Just swell. But listen, if Mr. Slade isn't here right now, why don't you come back in the morning?
Hey, no offense, but we don't take no orders from dames. Capisci?
First of all, that's not a word.
She don't speak French.
And second of all, if I tell you two morons to leave, you're turning around immediately and walking out that door. Capisce?
Yeah, sure thing, dollface. But you may want to tell your boss that we got the picture he's looking for, and we might be willing to give it to him for a price.
I think it's time for both of you to leave.
Sure.
Sure thing, sweet cheek.
Saturday cannot come quick enough.
Hey, Carolina. Veggies, did I miss anything?
Two guys just came by claiming they have the painting?
I doubt that. I think I know where it is. Matter of fact, I better go try to pick it up until tomorrow morning.
What time do things begin on Saturday?
Saturday. Oh, the dance. The studio. You know, Carol, you're a peach. Really, you are for agreeing to be my dance partner at all, but here's the thing. This case has really got me on my toes right now, and I'm afraid I'm not going to be able to make it Saturday. I'm sorry. I hope you understand.
Of course.
Besides, it's not like it was a date or anything, right?
It wasn't?
You're the best, Carolina. Best secretary there is. See you tomorrow.
So that's my answer, God? I'll become his best secretary?
quite a speech you gave those kids. Did I hear them call you Stan Slade?
Yeah.
Why? I believe you have something in mind, and I want it back.
The Sunday performance, we take a little break from the drama to talk a little bit about what the story has to say to us. All of the characters in this play are looking for something that they don't have any idea how it fits into the bigger picture. These gangsters, bunch of idiots, only see their own reflection, and to them, the meaning of life is what they see reflected in their own lives. For Annabelle, the ex-fiancée of the private detective, she only sees the picture of conniving, doing anything she can to get Stan back. Angel McLeod and the gang of pirate gangsters, that's a kind of a stretch, isn't it? They see it only for the value that it is to somebody else. But it's the art appraiser that tells the story. That the beauty of a painting is what it means to the artist. Here's the parable for our lives. The beauty of your life is what God created you to be. You are beautiful because He made you in His own image. So here's the thing. How do we find our place in the big picture? The Apostle Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians, "Now we see but a poor reflection as in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know even as I am fully known." While we're in this world, we just get glimpses of our place in God's big picture. But the Bible record is that there'll come a day when we understand who we are in God's image, what our place in the world is. In the meantime, we work together. We put our different contributions, our different lives together to paint a beautiful picture of God's kingdom. We're going to have a hymn of invitation. We invite you to publicly profess your faith in Christ, to find your place in the bigger picture of life. We also open the doors of the church to you. And David is here, and we're prepared to welcome you into the church family today. We're going to stand and sing this wonderful old invitation hymn, and you come.
The mysterious stranger eventually told me his name, Harvey Hopewell. He was one of the richest men in the city, but he was very much a recluse, rarely seen in public. He seemed to always be shrouded in mystery. For example, somehow, after the stock market crashed, when every other rich person became poor, he seemed to do just fine, even keeping his large mansion. And now it appears that this painting originally belonged to him. That just added to the mystery. I was hoping to find out some answers when I brought him to my office. So, Mr. Hopewell, how do I know this painting is yours?
Because it has my name on it. It's on the back, underneath the mat. I know it's not very good. I was 7 years old when I painted it. I chose the largest piece of paper I could for my masterpiece. But I tell you, my children surprised me on my 50th birthday. They framed it, presented it to me with a lot of fanfare and hoopla. They named it The Big Picture. Quite frankly, they didn't know what it was supposed to be, and they didn't have a better name for it. It was supposed to, since then, it's been a constant reminder of what the big picture in life is truly about. Family and faith. It's supposed to be a church. I learned a lot from my parents and my church. Unfortunately, art wasn't one of them.
So the picture has sentimental value.
It does, and I suppose you're wondering if it has any monetary value. From what I saw of your character in the alley, you deserve that. You see, Mr. Slade, I'm a lucky man, and a blessed man. My wife, Barbara, she never trusted banks, put even less faith in the stock market. With her persistence, I began selling off all of my stocks, and I put them in savings account at the bank. But they remained there for years, but that didn't make her happy. So one day, she finally wore me down. I went to the bank to withdraw all of my money. Of course, I was planning on putting it back the very next day.
But you didn't.
I couldn't. The next day was October 29, 1929. The stock market crashed. The banks began to close. That one day, God chose to answer prayers I hadn't even prayed yet. He opened up his arms and protected me. My wife and I are still living in that large mansion with all those vacant rooms. We still have our money while others suffer. And that needs to change. The money I'm giving you today, that's a start.
You know, I think I know another way. Those kids you saw in the alley, they're homeless. They're orphans, frankly. And could you have a place for them to live? Frankly, you have the means to provide for them. I think I could find someone to help you and your wife manage your house. I know it's a crazy idea, Mr. Hopewell, but what do you say?
I said, God's arms have always been open to me. I'll open up my house and my arms to those kids. But I should check with my wife first.
Of course, of course. Thank you so much. It would be great for the kids. Now, let's find the painting, shall we? Just a minute. Carol. Where's the painting?
You told me to get rid of it, remember? I threw it in the trash.
That's how I lost it to begin with. So, Carol, what's it like working here with Stan Slater?
At times, he's cranky, irritable, and sometimes downright bossy. But I love him here, working here.
It's not there! The painting's gone! Angel McCloud! Hey, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to rush back to the uptown to pick up your painting. Even if I have to pay Angel all the money you gave me, you're getting your big picture back. And then, we're celebrating. After you. Carol, would you mind meeting me at the uptown? I still owe you a dance.
Sure.
I need to speak to her right away.
Well, well, Stan. How does it feel to have something stolen out from under you?
I suppose you're here for the painting. I just hope you can pay what I'm asking.
As a matter of fact, I'm going to get the painting back that you stole from Mr. Oakwell originally. Don't deny it. I know I had to go picking through people's trash looking to find gold, but this time you thought you had it, didn't you? No. He cares. He's the only person that cares about this painting.
And I'm sure he's willing to pay for it.
He is. Here. You know, when times get tough, the temptation is to look at yourself.
Oh,
Did you buy the painting?
Nah, but I found this.
Sorry, boys, you're a little late. Good luck next time. Oh, who has a painting and where is it?
I have it, Carolina. I actually have it.
Woo! Where did you find it?
You're not going to believe it. In Angel's office. I was about to walk right out of there when all of a sudden, I heard a gang of pirates that were walking through the uptown. They're looking for it, too. So I slipped out the window. What do you think about that? Oh, by the way, have you received a call from Marion Burton?
Who's she? Another ex-girlfriend?
No, she's an art appraiser. That could be her now. Are you married?
I am indeed. Mr. Slade, I presume?
Pleased to meet you. Come right in. Carol will be looking at my office. It'll look at my office at the bank. All right. So I hope you can tell me this is worth a lot of money.
This is what you want me to look at?
Is there a problem?
Well, Mr. Slade, I hate to say this, but this looks like a child's painting.
Yeah, but can't you say that about a lot of famous paintings?
Perhaps. But those weren't done by actual children. I'm not sure about this one, but I guarantee you it's only worth the paper it's painted on. And that's not much these days. I'm so sorry.
I just can't seem to get a break.
Mr. Slade, do you mind if I share a little secret with you?
If it's a secret on how I can make a fortune in the Depression, I'm all ears.
Well, I don't have a secret to that one, but I do believe I know the secret to happiness.
Learning how to lie. and I mean...
I wouldn't hold your breath on it. I had it checked out. It's no piece of art, just random color slapped on by an amateur. About this husband of yours, you seem more concerned about this painting than you do him.
Well,
aren't you concerned if I found a lead on his whereabouts or something?
Certainly.
I'm beginning to wonder if this husband of yours even exists.
Oh, Stan, I'm so sorry. I was trying to make you jealous. And, well, the thing about the painting, I never had it, but I thought if I did, then we could sell the painting and have all the money we needed to begin a new life together. Happily ever after.
Oh, he doesn't. Happily ever after with you? Happiness based on lies? Are you kidding me? No, I know I can never be happy with you, Annabelle. You need to go. You know where the door is. Oh, Annie.
Yes?
You want this?
Just put it in the trash.
After Annie left, I needed to clear my head. I headed to a familiar alley in downtown Chicago. How's it going, kids? Making any money today? To focus on your strengths or your flaws. But you're only looking in a mirror. You're not seeing the big picture. But God does. My problem is, I've been waiting on God, but it's really Him who's been waiting on me. To turn this mirror and turn from it and to look at something greater, bigger than myself. But we've all got to do it. Together. So, Amy, how about you give Mr. Hopewell his painting back, and then we share the dough?
Well, Stan, it looks like you just got some religion. And if that makes us rich, then I say hallelujah!
Hallelujah! And get the painting. Very good, Mr. Hopewell.
And I'll take the money.
Okay. I'll give you the half of it. I'll get it on the bank.
Thank you. And by the way, Barbara said yes.
Really? That's fantastic. That's wonderful to hear.
Don't mind me. I'm just getting my things.
Do you like kids?
Oh, yes.
I think she could be a big help. You'll see. You'll see. You're going to love it. You're going to love it. So, do you think God hears our prayers?
I say He certainly heard mine. Honestly, I believe He always hears and answers. His timing, His way. He sees what we can't sometimes. By the way, you did good today.
I just had to see the big picture.
Oh.
Say one more thing to you before you do that. Yeah.
drop down a little bit and you'll be here. There you go. That way you can see so many people. Hey! All right.